Oh, magnify the Lord with us and let us exalt his name together. Come on, Zion, let's raise praise to our King. Come on, let's raise praise to our God. We come to send up a praise to our almighty Savior, to our awesome Redeemer. Come on, somebody lift your voice and shout praise to our King. Father, we shout hallelujah in your presence. God, we send up praise to you. Come on, put your hands on it. Glory, we sing to the King of the earth. We bow down in reverence. You are the sovereign God we serve. We bow down in reverence. You are the sovereign God we serve. Room for you to dwell here. We worship and we adore you. We make room for you to dwell here. Let your train fill this symbol. Let your glory arise from the earth. Let your train fill this symbol. Let your glory arise from the earth.
Holy.
Come on, somebody shout holy.
Holy.
That we would like you to fill our houses. Sing, fill this house with your glory. Come on, Zion, let's make that declaration. Sing, fill this house with your presence. That's our heart's cry. Sing, fill this house with your glory. Father, we cry out for your glory. Sing, fill this house with your presence. Oh, sing, fill this house with your glory. We cry out for your glory. Sing, fill this house with your presence. Now come on, let's make this prayer. Sing, we want you.
Your glory.
Come on, raise it up.
Fill this house with your presence. Oh, fill this house with your glory.
We cry out for more of your glory.
Fill this house,
yes, sir,
with your presence.
Fill this house.
Fill this house.
Fill this house.
Fill this house.
this house with your glory. Oh, sing, fill this house. Fill this house with your presence. Sing, fill this house. Fill this house with your glory. Sing, fill this house. Fill this house with your presence. Come on, say, we want you. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to let you know that Jesus is the answer for the world today. We want to welcome everyone to our Seize the Moment worship experience here on Good Friday at Mount Zion Church of Greensboro, North Carolina. What a joy it is to be able to lift up and to magnify the name of the Lord right here on Good Friday virtually. Here's what we're doing today. Today, we will have the seven last sayings of Jesus Christ while dying and hanging on that cross. And we have some powerful, powerful men and women of God that are here that are going to be sharing, and it's an honor to serve with them today. But here's what I want you to do. I want each and every one of you, I want you to share this right now. I want you to share it if you're on Facebook Live right now. I want you to share it if you're on YouTube. Let somebody know that we're on. If you're part of our church online, we welcome all of you. I just believe that God is going to meet us today right where we are, and we're going to be better off because of the anointing and power of God that is going to meet us right in your home, wherever you may be. I know you feel the joy of the Lord already, and I am already standing in tiptoe anticipation, waiting for what God has in store for us. So while you are sharing and getting others to tune in, I want to let you know who we have that will be preaching and sharing these seven last sayings of Jesus Christ with me. We have Bishop Sir Walter Mack of the Union Baptist Church of Winston-Salem, North Carolina, powerful preacher and teacher and pastor. He's going to be sharing the word of the Lord with us. Also, we have Pastor Leah McNair of the Emmanuel Baptist Church of Thomasville, North Carolina. She serves right beside her husband, Pastor Michael McNair. They're doing a wonderful job in Thomasville. And then also we have Dr. Darren Mitchell from Trinity AME Zion Church right here in Greensboro, North Carolina. It's going to be blessing our hearts. I want us to prepare right now to receive the word of God. I want us to prepare our hearts right now to receive as these vessels pour out unto us. Let us receive them now.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand praise, and we thank God for God being God. We give honor to Bishop and to First Lady, and let us now go into the word of the Lord. In Luke, the 23rd chapter, the 34th verse, it says that, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they divided garments and cast lots right there. I want to talk about being thankful for forgiveness. Being thankful for forgiveness. It was Jim Bishop in his book, The Day That Christ Died, who declared that when Jesus hung on the cross, that it was not just a mere crucifixion, but it was a messianic massacre. He goes on and he talks about the physiological things that Jesus went through while hanging there on the cross. He says that while he was hanging there, his intercostal muscles began to spasm. His pectoral muscles began to cramp, and fire-like feeling ran through the nerves of his body. He goes on and he talks about how carbon dioxide filled his lungs such that all he could do while hanging there on the cross were to utter words like, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I want you to know that that's what we find here in this given text. We find a place where forgiveness is foremost. Forgiveness is releasing somebody else from the pain of payback. I found myself understanding that forgiveness is when you release someone from the action that you could have taken. And when forgiveness is done right, you need to know that it does more for you than the one that offended you. And that's what we find here in this given text. We find a place that Jesus is now hanging as a mangled body on a blood-soaked tree. And while he is up there, he utters these words, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." You need to know that this is not just merely a pronouncement or a statement, but when he utters these words, you need to know that Jesus is whispering a prayer. It is a prayer, a petition, because he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Now, we have the petition, but we don't have the answer. We don't see what God answer him after his petition. But I do want you to know that we have a God on our side who knows how to answer prayer. Understand that there are times when God will answer our prayer, and some of you know that he'll answer prayer, but there are times when God will answer our prayer and he'll say yes to our prayers. Understand that all of us are the beneficiary of a yes to our prayers. There are times when God has blessed us with favor after we have prayed for favor. He said yes to some of our prayers because he has healed some of our bodies, and he has open doors that no man or woman can shut. God will say a yes to a prayer. But there are times when God won't just say yes to a prayer, but he'll say no to a prayer. I wish I had some help in here. Understand that all of us are here because he said no to a prayer. Had he said yes to Jesus's prayer when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he prayed, "Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, thy will be done," none of us would be here right now. But I'm so glad that he said no to that prayer. Because he said no, we are able to gain salvation in our lives. Understand that there are times when God will say yes, there are times when God will say no, and then there are times when God will say not right now. But I'm so glad that delay does not mean denied. He whispered a prayer and said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And don't you know, church, that after he whispered that prayer, we don't know what the answer was, but we know who Jesus is. And if he prayed that prayer, "Father, forgive them," we just believe that the Father forgave them. Well, who is the them that he's talking about? Who is it that he's referencing when he says, "Father, forgive them"? Well, some thought that he was referring to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, who were praying that a Messiah would come, but didn't recognize that he was the Messiah. Some of us are the same way, and we stand in need of forgiveness right now because the Lord has already blessed us, and we're still looking for a blessing. If he woke you up this morning, that's a blessing. If he started you on his way, that's a blessing. If he gave you food on your table, that's a blessing. if he is giving you protection, even now, that is a blessing. Some thought that he was talking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Some thought that he was referencing the switchers. You need to know who the switchers are. Those are they who switched up on him and cried Hosanna on Sunday, but crucify him on Friday. I want you to know that the reason that you have to have forgiveness in your life is because there are some people who will switch up on you, and they'll be your friend one day and don't know you the next day. That's why in my life I have two sets of friends. I have those that are in my square and then those that are my circle. Now my square are those who just know me from a distance, and I know them from a distance. That's my square. But my circle are those who know me and I know them, and what we know we'll take it to our graves. I wish I had some help in here. You need some squares in your life. You need some circles in your life. But let me tell you that my circle can fit in my square, but my square can't fit in my circle. I wish I had some help in here. Don't y'all know that you have some switchers that you need to ask God to give you the spirit to forgive them for switching up on you? Some believe that Jesus was not just praying for the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the switchers, but he was also praying for the robbers for whom he hung between. Because you need to know that Luke does not call them thieves, he calls them robbers. There is a difference between a thief and a robber. You need to know that a thief is one, a hun, that will rob you from the back door. He'll take from you and you won't even know it. That's a thief. But a robber is somebody that will rob you openly right there in your face. Can I tell y'all tonight that he hung between two robbers? And isn't it interesting that they robbed openly and he forgave them openly? So then now they believe that he was praying for the Pharisees. They believe that he was praying for the switchers. They believe that he was praying for the robbers. And don't you know that while he was up there, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I wish I had a little help in here. And I want y'all to know that all of us right now are standing in need of forgiveness. Some believe that he was praying for the others, but I want you to know that when we read this given text, you cannot divorce yourself from the text, because I believe that he was praying for you and I. He saw down through the dim mysteries of time and saw that we would have been born in sin and shaped in iniquity. I wish I can tell you that all of my life I have dotted every I and crossed every T, but I wouldn't be here right now if it had not been for the Lord on my side. And don't you know, church, that he prayed for you and I. And there are times in this life that when you realize that you are forgiven, you have to forgive others, because all of us are healed by grace. Do I have a witness in here? I'm so glad that the theologian described what grace was. When the theologian said that grace is no more than snow that is covered by manure. Hang on to that for just a little while. It's snow that's covered by manure. And there are two things when you see snow that covers manure. When snow covers manure, two things about to happen. One, you can't see it. And the other thing is that you can't smell it. Do I have a witness in here? And I want y'all to know right now, that there are some things in my life, because he has forgiven me, that you can't see, and there's some stuff you can't smell. You ought to just fist bump somebody and say, I'm so glad that I don't look like and I don't smell like everything I've been through. Do I have a witness in here? I want y'all to know that there are times when we have to forgive because we have been forgiven. As I moved to my clothes, I was on a plane some time ago, and I boarded the plane, and the plane was already full. And don't you know that people were looking at me? as if to say, I hope that this man doesn't have to sit beside me. And don't you know that I end up sitting beside a little lady, who was sitting in the chair. And when she saw me coming to sit beside her, I could see the attitude and the grimace on her face. She hastily gets up because the plane is already tight. And I sat down in my seat, and she sat back down, and she pulled the arm of the chair down as if it was not already tight on the plane. Do I have a witness in here? But then she turned her body opposite on me as if to say, don't touch me and I won't touch you. Well, I didn't have any intentions of touching her, but she wanted to socially distance herself from me. But don't you know that as the plane took off and we got to high altitudes, don't you know that we hit one of those pockets and the plane dropped real fast and it started shaking. And the next thing I know is that her little hand was on my knee. And I looked, I said, oh, now you want to touch me. Do I have a witness in here? That now that we're in trouble. But in that moment, I could have held that against her. But right then I forgave her. And I started praying for her. And I started talking to her. And I said, you can calm down because we gonna be all right. And I want y'all to know, as I move to my clothes, that I thank God for mercy. And I thank God for grace. But I thank God for forgiveness. That's what he was doing when he was born in Bethlehem. Good God Almighty. And he was reared in Nazareth. And he was baptized in the Jordan. And they tell me that he prayed in Gethsemane. And after he prayed, he allowed them to put a cross upon his back. And they led him down the Via Dolorosa. And they hung him high. And they stretched him wide. And they put nails in his hands. Do I have a witness in here? But in spite of the nails, he still forgave them. They put nails in his feet. He still forgave them. They put a crown of thorns on top of his head, but he still forgave them. And it was after they hung him high that he died. I said he died. He died on the cross until somebody looked down through the dim mysteries of time and said, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all his world go free? There is a cross for everyone, and there is a cross for me. I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm so glad that he died. I'm so glad that he shedded his blood. And it was his blood that saved me. It was his blood that redeemed me. I'm so glad that I thank God for the blood. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. Every time I think about Jesus, I get happy. I get excited. My soul gets happy. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Yeah, yeah. Good God Almighty. Every time I turn around, he keeps on making a way for me. Yeah, yeah. The blood. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. Good God Almighty. Yeah.
Luke chapter number 23, verse 43, the New International Version, we find these words. Jesus answered him, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you now for this day, the day that you've made. Now let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart, let it be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you're my God, my strength, and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Life is a continuum of moments. Life is lived from moment to moment. Oftentimes, many of us are so caught up in what is going to happen next that we miss the moment that we are in right now, which is why so many of us live life in frustration, because it's hard to manage missed moments. And although all of us have had moments in our lives that have been pivotal, but there will always be some moments that seem to stick out more than others, like the one that has captured our hearts and summoned us all together for such a time as this, which I believe is a divine moment. A moment where Jesus is centered between two criminals, one on his left and the other on his right, where he becomes the substitutionary atonement for our sins. I see three things here in this moment that I want to lift up, and I'll get out of your way. Number one, I see a painful predicament, a painful predicament. In Luke 23, verse 33 of the New International Version, it says, when they came to the place called the skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. I want you to notice, beloved, how painful and how difficult this must have been for Jesus. Think about the emotional difficulty that he was facing, because remember, he is in this predicament because of a friend that betrayed him. Can you just imagine for just a moment, the person that is kissing on you is the same person that is plotting and scheming, trying to kill you. That's why you have to be careful who you allow to get close to you. He also went through the psychological difficulty, because they began to mock Jesus and they began to laugh at him when they twisted those thorns into what looked like a wreath into his head and pushed it into his brow. They were teasing him about being king of the Jews. Not only is this psychological and emotional difficulty, but what about the physical pain and difficulty? Because they whipped Jesus all night long, and they nailed his hands and they spiked his feet. Jesus here was going through pain and difficulty. And I want you to know that when you go through painful, difficult predicaments in your life, that is not the moment for you to give up. That is not the moment for you and I to walk away from God and turn our back on the church. But you have to be willing to seize those moments, because I found out, here it is, that there is deliverance in difficulty. Not only was Jesus' predicament painful because of the difficulty, but when you look at it, it was painful because of the darkness. Because verse 44 says, it was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until there 3 in the afternoon. I need you to understand the period of time that it got dark, from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Now, there are times when we expect darkness. We expect darkness late in the evening, and everybody is going to go through darkness. If you're watching me, if you can hear me, no matter where you are, no matter who you may be, each each and every one of us will experience some dark times, some dark moments. But the problem comes when it's the darkest, when it should be the brightest. The problem is when it's the darkest and it should be the brightest. At noon, it ought to be the brightest time in my life. But this verse says that there are times when it should be the brightest that it ends up being the darkest. And if you and I are not careful, the enemy will try to get us to turn our back on God in those moments. But I've got some good news for someone today, because it is in those moments that God wants to move in your life. Because we serve a God who specializes in doing great things in dark times. In fact, everything that God ever used went through a dark place. Moses spent 40 years on the backside of the desert in a dark place. Jacob stumbles upon the mountaintop and wrestles with an angel that took place in a dark place. Paul and Silas was locked in that Philippian jail, but the Bible says that at midnight, when it got dark, they prayed and they sang praises unto God and the chains fell off. I want you to understand that great things take place in the dark. At night, God specializes in doing great things in dark times. The thing that the devil is most afraid of, ladies and gentlemen, is someone who can praise God in the dark. The thing that the enemy is the most fearful of is someone who could lift your hands and praise God in the midst of dark times. And perhaps I'm preaching to somebody right now, you're in the middle of a dark season, but if you would just lift your hands right where you are and give God glory, you will come to discover that God specializes in working miracles in dark moments. Here's the second thing that I see. Not only do we see here a painful predicament, but the second thing that I see here is a personal plea. Personal plea. Verse 42 says, then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, this is a picture of a great sinner who recognizes the need for a great savior. Pay attention to his plea, ladies and gentlemen, because this man's plea is filled with responsibility and repentance. Watch this, because look at how he checks his partner in crime as he says to him that we're getting what we deserve, but this man has done no wrong. This is interesting, because while the church deserted Christ, this criminal defends Christ. Then he goes on to say in verse 42, remember me. Here it is, a personal plea. He says, remember me. I like this criminal. He is what we call a smooth criminal, because in this verse, he doesn't mention his partner in crime. And in this verse, he doesn't mention the other thief or anybody else. He simply says, Lord, remember me. And I know I'm a criminal and I know I'm a crook, but Lord, I need you to remember me. I know I have a past and I know I made some mistakes, but Lord, I need you to remember me. Lord, I know I'm not perfect, but I need you to remember me. And this verse reminds me that there comes a point in all of our lives that we have to make it personal. Because hear me, ladies and gentlemen, there are some things that nobody else can do for you. You've got to go on and do it for yourself. Listen, if you get tired, nobody else can rest for you. You have to pause and rest for yourself. You got to lay down for yourself. If you get hungry, can't nobody else eat for you. You have to go on and eat for yourself. If you get thirsty, can't nobody drink for you. You have to drink for yourself. Here's what I'm trying to tell you, that if you're going to know Jesus, you've got to know him for yourself. Let me say it like this, because I have real good insurance. My insurance is comprehensive. It not only covers me, but it covers my wife and my children. So if something goes down in my life, or something goes down in even their lives, what happens is they benefit from the insurance. Watch this, because I'm her husband and I'm their father. But y'all, salvation doesn't work like that. You got to be able, watch this, to know him for yourself. You see, when it comes to salvation, you may be able to get in on your mother or your father's insurance, but when it comes to salvation, you've got to have your own assurance. You have to make it personal. You have to personally say, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. My grandfather used to say, son, you can't go through life parking on somebody else's nickel. Sooner or later, you're going to have to put some money in the machine for yourself. Grandpa was simply trying to tell me that Bryan, you're going to have to make it personal. Come here, Bible readers. Y'all remember in John chapter 9, a man was born blind and Jesus healed him. The religious police started tripping, so they brought his parents in and they started questioning his parents about their grown son. Was he born blind from birth? Can he see now? And the parents said, listen, our son is of age. Don't ask us. Go and ask him. When they finally reached the man that was blind, he said, why y'all asking my mama and my daddy about what happened to me? It didn't happen to them, whereas I was blind, but now I can see. The Apostle Paul said in the New Testament that I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that in which I commit unto him. Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'm just trying to tell somebody that you got to make it personal. Here's the third thing, and I'm out of your way. I see a present promise. Somebody ought to write that down, a present promise. In verse 43, Jesus answered him. He says, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Now notice the type of promise that he gives to this criminal. It's the promise of paradise. It is the promise of restoration instead of retribution. It is the promise of amazing grace and abundant mercy. It is the promise of no condemnation. It is the promise of another chance. Maybe you're not a criminal. Maybe you've never been found guilty of anything, but for the rest of us that can at least look back over our life and find at least one thing that we should have been condemned for, but he gave you another chance, I dare you right where you are to lift your hands and tell the Lord thank you. Now then notice here the tense in which it is given. Jesus tells him today. He says today, which means it's in the present tense. Why is this important? It is important, ladies and gentlemen, because whenever Jesus is speaking to us, he is always speaking in the present tense. But whenever you and I are speaking to him, we're always speaking in the future tense.
Here it is. He says today. And then we start talking about what we're going to do tomorrow and next week and next month and next year and next time. And here's my question. In the midst of a pandemic where people are losing their lives, who promised you next week? Who promised you next month? Who promised you next year? Who promised you next time? Listen to me. You and I, ladies and gentlemen, are trapped in the fraction now. When you look back to yesterday, that's recollection. When you look forward to tomorrow, that's speculation. All we have is right now. Stop talking about what you're going to do next week and next month and next year and next time. Because the truth is, this week is next week because you said that last week. This month is next month because you said that last month. This year is next year because you said that last year. This time is next time because you said that last time. Here's what I'm trying to tell somebody that could hear me and see me. Stop putting off tomorrow for what you need to be doing today, which means whatever you're going to do for God, you need to go on and do the doggone thing now. If you got a song to sing, you ought to sing it now. If you got a sermon to preach, you ought to preach it now. If you've got some love to give, you ought to give it now. And if you got a praise to release, you ought to open your mouth and release a praise right now. Let me close. Here's what the poet said. The poet said, I have only but a minute, only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon me, can't refuse it. Didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it, give an account if I abuse it. I have only but a minute, but eternity is in it. In other words, what you do with your right now will determine your not yet. And what you do with your today will determine your tomorrow. I'm done, but I've got to tell somebody at least two things before I leave you. Your tomorrow is today, and your next is now. If you believe it, you ought to jump up and give them praise. Because since your next is now, your praise should be now. Since your next is now, your hallelujah should be now. Since your next is now, your thank you, Jesus, it ought to be now. Since your next is now, you ought to go on and dance now. Is there anybody here that ever been through a problem? Is there anybody watching me? You're going through an issue right now. Here's what God told me to tell you. Today is your day. You ought to seize this moment with a praise. Because when your problem gets to your promise, your problems will be in the no longer. What I'm trying to tell you here is don't wait until the battle is over, but shout right now, because today is your day. Anybody feel like this is a divine moment? You're not going through it by yourself. If you believe today is your day, right where you are, say yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Somebody praise him right where you are, because this is your today moment. This is your divine moment. I need a praise. I need somebody lift your hands. Tell the Lord, thank you. I'm done, but today it is your day. Yeah. It's your day, my friend. It's your day, my brother. It's your day, my sister. You've been hurting. You've been going through. You've been waiting for a long time. But today, we gotta go. Today is your day. Praise him right where you are. Cause today is your day. It's your day. It's your day. It's your day. It's your hour. It's your season. It's your time.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I know we're not together today, but we're together in spirit. Wherever you are, would you just bless the name of the Lord with me? God, we give you glory. God, we give you praise. We magnify you today because your name is worthy of the glory, of the honor. God, we give you a high praise today. We give you a high praise. Today we give honor to the bishop, to Bishop Bryan Pierce, and to the queen of the house, to Lady Deb Pierce, my dear sister and friend. We honor you today. What a privilege to be in this house today and to be amongst these great men of God that are bringing the seven last sayings of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm honored today to be able to come to you from John 16, 26 and 27. Let's jump right in. The word of the Lord reads, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. From that hour, the disciple took her in to his own household. I want to really just hone in on verse number 26. When Jesus saw her, when he saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Father, today we give you praise. We give you honor. We ask you to speak through your word the way only you can. In Jesus' name, amen. My brothers and my sisters, if you allow me for just a moment, I would like to talk to you from the topic, God has not forgotten. God has not forgotten. In this third saying of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, he is illuminating the limitless touch that our Savior gives to those who need him. John is showing us that there is no time or space, and God himself, through Jesus, who was wrapped in sinful flesh, will use his son to go through extreme measures to get to you and to me. I'm definitely talking about the touch of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's a touch that changes, a touch that heals, a touch that delivers, a touch that tears down, a touch that builds up, a touch that covers and saves and restores. John reminds us by painting a clear and precise picture of our Savior in his divinity. He masterfully displays the seamless way in which our Lord completes his divine assignment. While hanging there on the cross, my brothers and my sisters, I want you to remember that he has the thorns in his crown, and the crown is on his head. The nails are piercing his head. Hands, but yet he takes a moment in time to focus beneath him just long enough to touch the needs of a particular woman. He looks down and he focuses in on this woman, not just any woman, y'all, but this is his mother, Mary. Mary, our constant reminder reminder that there is no gospel without a woman. Oh, Lord. I said what I said today. There is no gospel without a woman. Mary, she is our biblical billboard to remind us that woman is an instrumental and invaluable contribution to the kingdom of God. I'm looking for somebody to give us sisters our props today. And since I'm the only chick on the lineup, I may as well go on and do the doggone thing. I want you to know that there's nothing like a kingdom woman. There's nothing like a woman who prays, who praises, who preaches, who prophesies. There's nothing like a woman who can push. I may not get hearts from everybody, but I'm looking for some sisters today. Throw me some hearts in the chat. I'm looking for some kingdom women that realize that you are instrumental in this hour to the kingdom of God. There's nothing like a woman who can push the agenda of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And let us not forget that Mary's push in Luke chapter 2 wrapped Jesus in sinful flesh, brought him into the earth to save us. It was Mary's push that got him here. Knowing the severity of his assignment, knowing what it would entail and what he would have to go through with her fears and her reservations, with her feelings of not being prepared, Mary pushed anyway. Let us not forget that it was Mary's push in John chapter 2 at the wedding feast of Cana that shifted Jesus into his season of miracles. Despite his clear words to his mother that it wasn't his time yet, the Bible says that Mary pushed anyway. And here she is again. Here we find Mary again, and she's pushing Jesus. She's not by herself, but verse 25 says that she's with her girls. The three Marys are at the foot of the cross. Mary, her sister, and Mary Magdalene join Mary, the mother of Jesus, to stand there and support the work of Jesus Christ. They're doing just what us girls know how to do. They're pushing. And I can imagine that Mary's silent presence at the foot of the cross is a push for Jesus. I can imagine that as the crowd of supporters faded and Jesus could look down below him and see that there was nobody left at the foot of the cross except his mother and Jesus. And this is intriguing to me, Mount Zion, that out of all of the lives that Jesus touched, that he could only look down and see two or three. He could only look down and see his mother and John, the disciple whom he loved. Now, this is my question, and I'm going to move on because I only got a little bit of time. But my question is, where were the other disciples? Where was Andrew? Where was James? Where was Philip? Where was Bartholomew? Where was Thomas? Where was Peter? And Simon, better yet, where was Bartimaeus? Where was Jairus? Where was Lazarus? Where was the dude at the pool of Bethesda? Where was the dude with the withered hand? Where was the one who came down through the roof? Where was Zacchaeus? Where was the woman with the issue of blood? Where were they? Where were the ones that Jesus touched and Jesus healed and Jesus changed? But when the heat got turned up a little higher, we could find nobody there but Mary and John. And here it is, y'all. Here's the problem right here, staring us in the face. You have a sea of people who have gone AWOL from Jesus. You have a sea of people who have lost their appreciation for God, lost their reverence, their fear of God. And when it got tight, they missed the shift because they were not in place. And I, for one, am thankful that God has chosen to shake us in this season, because there's nothing I don't want more. There's nothing that I don't want God to do more than to leave me out of the shift. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I don't want God to leave me out of the shift. And these people backed away from Jesus just in the moment where he was shifting and making a transition, going higher in God. And just as he was going higher, they go further away from him. I don't know about you, but this is not the time to be out of place. This is not the time to back away from Jesus. This is not the time to let the pressure of this pandemic make you miss God. Oh, Lord. And I don't know if I'm the only one, but my prayer today is, God, don't let me miss you. Don't let me be so caught up in so many other things that I miss you. I don't want to miss you. I don't want to miss your glory. I don't want to miss your assignment. The Bible says that many had backed away from the Lord. The masses were looking for a bailout plan. Nobody could be found at the scene of the cross. But there was Mary standing in her place. They see him using Mary right there just because she's standing. And I want to talk to somebody that's finding it hard to stand under the pressure of what you're going through. People see you now and they see what you're walking through and what you're doing for the Lord, but they don't know what it costs you to be at his feet. They don't know what it costs you to be close to the Lord. They are nowhere to be found, but Mary is right there. No notoriety, no flyer, no logo, no parking space, no title, but she's right there. And if 2020 ain't taught you nothing, I know 2020 has taught you that you don't need a whole squad behind you. You just need one or two people that'll be in place. You just need one or two people that'll stand in their place. I wish I could tell you where to go to find the cure to corona, where to go to stand and find the immunity, where to go to find the best business payroll plan. I can't tell you where to find all of that. I can't tell you when our kids will go back to school, but I can tell you this, that the ones that'll find favor in this season are the ones that'll be at his feet and in place. The Bible says she was standing at the foot of the cross. And here's where I'm going to get just a little bit happy, if you'll allow me to, Zion. She stands at the foot of the cross and Jesus gives her one thing. He didn't give her notoriety. He didn't give her spotlight. He didn't give her tangible things. But the Bible says in verse number 26 that he said, "Woman, here is your son. John, here is your mother." God, out of all the things that Jesus could give her, he replaced what she was losing before she actually lost it. And I gotta go, but before I do, I want to talk to somebody that thinks God has forgotten about you. I want to talk to somebody that thinks God has overlooked you. I came to prophesy to you today and to let you know that for every prayer you pray, for every night you cried, for every time you gave God glory, God said, I will remember you. I want to talk to somebody who thinks God has forgotten about you. You think God has forgotten your prayers, has forgotten your praises, has forgotten your sacrifice. God said, I have not forgotten, and I will remember you. God said, I will remember you for every praise you praise, for every night you cried. Your name just dropped in the ears of God. For every time you dance with no evidence, for every time you hollered with no way out, God said, I will remember you. And when I remember you, I'll replace what you lost. I'll replace what you sacrificed. I'll replace what you gave up. I'll replace your tears with joy. I'll replace your mourning with dancing. I need you to find somebody somewhere in your house and say, neighbor, God has not forgotten. Say, neighbor, God has not forgotten. I came to tell you today that God's getting ready to replace what you lost. God's getting ready to repay what you lost. God's getting ready to repossess what you lost. If you believe it, give God glory. I said, give him glory.
Would you pray with me? God, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the privilege of being able to share your word. Thank you for the witness of your spirit, for the fragrance of faith that fills the atmosphere, that wherever we are, your presence is there, God. So we pray that you will allow your spirit to permeate this preachment, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. For God, you are the source of my strength. And you are the strength of my life. You are the strength of our lives and the source of our strength. So be God in this moment. Be big in this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. From the gospel according to St. Mark, the 15th chapter, beginning at verse 33, these words are recorded. Now, when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those who stood by when they heard that said, look, he is calling for Elijah. Then someone ran and filled a sponge full of sour wine, put it on a reed, and offered it to him to drink, saying, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come to take him down. For the time that's ours, I want to share from this thought a fearless dialogue from a painful place. Calvary, a death and a day that shall live in infamy. Calvary, place of accusation and execution, Calvary. Matchless yet mysterious drama put on display, Calvary. God's answer when I say it's impossible, Calvary. God's answer when I say I'm too tired. God's answer when I say nobody loves me and everybody takes me for granted, Calvary. God's answer when I say I can't go on, Calvary is the answer. God's answer when I say I can't figure it out. God's answer when I say I can't do it. God's answer when I say they hurt me so bad. The answer comes back from the sapphire gates of the celestial city, Calvary. God's answer when I say I've been used, misused, and abused. God's answer when I say it's not worth it. God's answer when I say I'm worried and frustrated. God's answer when I say I get so little in return, yet I give so much. The answer is Calvary. Calvary is not some mesmerizing spectacle on the page of human history. It goes beyond the nice crosses we put on churches, in churches, and around our necks. Calvary is a place for learning. Calvary is a place for instruction. Calvary is a setting for wisdom and understanding. Jesus is the professor. Humanity is the student. If you really want to hear, see, and feel a lesson being taught, explained, and explicated, go to Calvary. Want a lesson in disgust and dismay? Calvary 101, room G for Golgotha. Want to hear wisdom under fire? Come to the Calvary classroom and see the teacher at work and the genius in motion. Before you check out, check in to Calvary 101. I shudder to think, beloved, how God will judge us preachers for homiletical malfeasance, for sermonic jaywalking. Because the truth of the matter is, beloved, we do a great disservice, some people and some prognosticators, to the Christian faith when we sidestep and circumvent the journey of Jesus. Vernon John says that the problem with preaching in this so-called majority context is that we want a pristine, pretty, sterilized, sanitized Christology draped in the American rhetoric of rabid, narcissistic tribalism. We seek a Jesus that is devoid of struggle and strife. Jesus, the revolutionary liberator from the ghetto of Nazareth, is in persistent, perilous pain, but he's not a vegetable. He's been lynched by a mob of perverted pietists and power-hungry bureaucrats. But he's conscious. He's conscious of his surroundings. He's conscious of his predicament. He's conscious of the environment of rolling dice, gambling soldiers, weeping women, Stygian darkness, crumbling temples, torn up veils, resurrected saints, a presumptuous criminal, a penitent thief, fearful disciples, and a somewhat delinquent deity who's turned his back on his only child. He is executed not because he caused mischief, but because he met justice with mercy. Instead of hands of love being extended to him, he is met with the sting of men slapping his face. Instead of a crown of precious, priceless jewels and dazzling gems, his head is blood-soaked from the acute piercings of a thorny crown. Instead of a golden scepter in his hands, he is met with rusted spears and borrowed clothing. He is not showered with affection and warmth, but rather he is pummeled by hate and rejection. I'm going somewhere. He is maligned. He's misunderstood, even by those who were closest to him. Check this. And this dreadful extremity is punctuated by a poignant, plaintive question, which is among the most gut-wrenching and heart-rending expressions ever uttered in sacred scripture. My God, why have you forsaken me? His head cannot touch the sky. His hands and feet are spiked to a splintered cross. He could hardly catch his breath as he measures each breath with words that come from a deep place. And in this painful place, he gives a fearless and redemptive language that can be used by all who have to spend time in a painful place. Jesus spares no expense in sharing with us just how painful this place really is. And he does it to remind us that his experience is not something that is done in our stead only. It is part of our journey as well. The Bible, beloved, is not a why book. It's not a book that answers the questions of why things are as they are. It is clearly a how book that helps us work through the turbulent, torrential turmoil that faces every life. It does not answer why there is evil in the world, but it does show me how I can live when there's corruption all around me. It does not answer why do the heathen rage, but it does show me how to live in peace when the heathens harass me and get on my last nerve. It does not answer why bad things happen to good people, but it tells me how I can have peace when the rain falls on the just and the unjust. It does not tell me why Cain killed his brother Abel, but it does tell me how, when I give the best of my service, he'll understand and say, well done. It does not tell me why God allowed for Joseph's brothers to sell him into slavery, but it does show me how I can turn ugly into beautiful. It doesn't tell me why Job had to lose everything, but it does show me how to wait on God even in the midst of a hellish situation. Perhaps, beloved, one of the damnable acts to our humanity is to deny we have feelings. We got a cool swag because the mask with which we hide our true feelings and cover the real stirrings of our restless souls keep us distant from each other. Jesus identifies his pain and he gives voice to it. Can I say that again? Jesus identifies his pain and he gives voice to it. He says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You do know he got these words from the Psalter, Psalm 22 in our Bible. Jesus knew these words from a child, but now that he's grown enough to utter these words in a painful place, he is able to say them while he is spiked to a cross. Heretofore, he had been so intimate with his Father that he says, you, I, and the Father are one. But now in the midst of darkness, Jesus speaks in distinction from his Father. He does not call him Father. He calls him God. He's not relating to him intimately. He's relating to him as God. My God, my God. There is reality in this word. And if you would speak truthfully in this space, you would have to affirm that you have had to ask the same question in light of what we face since last Good Friday. Somebody has come to this place and you've been taught that certain questions you cannot ask God. But this dialogue on the cross is a fearless dialogue. It comes from a painful place. In other words, I don't have to put on fronts and jump hoops and put on masks. I don't have to impress friends and astound associates and amaze my enemies. I don't have to play make-believe to mystify some super holy saint, because when I'm hurting in pain, I can keep it real. But notice, y'all, he does not utter the words to whom it may concern. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's the feeling that he has in this moment. And brothers and sisters, I don't know how you feel about it, but I believe that Jesus asked the question to the right one. He asked the question to the one who had an answer.
Because there are times in our lives we ask the right questions to the wrong people. But he looks up to heaven and declares, my God, why? And notice, y'all, there is no answer. Because there are some things that God will not answer in the time we give God to answer. We may not understand the meaning of our misery, but God always has an answer. We may not see our way out of this desolate night of sorrow, but God always has an answer. For COVID-19, God has an answer. For economic devastation, God has an answer. For stock markets imploding, God has an answer. For health disparities, God has an answer. For voter suppression and gerrymandering, God has an answer. For hard times in our nation, God has an answer. For the crazy in every space and sector of our world, God has an answer. And he does not answer in the way or time that we give God. But if you hold on and wait a while, God will answer. My son was known for always ordering things. He wanted certain things. Especially when it came to eating. And whenever he come home from school, he would call and say, Daddy, I want you to go pick up something for me. He always had a specific order. And he said, Daddy, I want you to please, would you pick this up? Because I'm hungry and I'm waiting for you to give me something to eat. Now I'm wondering, did he eat while he was in school? But I realized that food is cheaper than medicine. So I decided to go by and pick up what he wanted. While I'm in the line, y'all, I'm sitting there. I've already placed my order. But the person that was standing outside directed me to come over to the side. And I started saying, Lord, why are you directing me over here? My son is calling me. My son is sitting there texting me. He's saying, Daddy, where is my order? What's taking so long? Why haven't you brought the order that I asked for? And then I decided that I wasn't going to answer him until I got home. Because when I got home, I had two bags in my hand. And when I got home, I told him, son, the reason why it took so long was it because it was a special order. And because special orders take time, they couldn't rush the order. But because I sat there patiently waiting, not only did they give me what I asked for, but they gave me something extra. I'll see you when I see you. But can I tell somebody that if you learn how to wait on the Lord and be of good courage, he will strengthen thine heart. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as an eagle. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. I'll see you when I see you. But can I go old school? We are often tossed and driven, battered by an angry sea, when the storms of life are raging and the fury fall on me. I wonder what I've done to make this race so hard to run. But then I say to my soul, don't you worry, the Lord, he will make a way somehow. I don't know how long life will be. I don't know how long we gotta deal with what we're dealing with. But I came to tell somebody, hold on, hold on, hold on. Because he may not come when you want him to. But the Lord is always, yes he is, he's always on time. I don't know why, but I'm not asking God why, I'm just asking God when. I'm not asking God how, but I'm asking God when. Because I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how, but I do know the Lord
Praise God. Right where you are, you feel His presence. I want you to just lift your hands, continue to worship Him. There is nothing, absolutely nothing, like worshiping God. There is nothing like lifting up the name of the Lord. For in His presence, there is fullness of joy. And at His right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. My God, my God. Listen, we're moving. And I want to present to you these next three preachers that are going to declare the word of the Lord. We're going to have Bishop George W. Brooks, who's going to come and share the word of God with you. He served for 37 years as the senior pastor of this great church right here, Mount Zion Baptist Church of Greensboro. And so we're excited to hear the word from him, followed by Dr. Curtis H. Brown of the New Light Missionary Baptist Church right here of Greensboro, North Carolina, and then followed by Bishop James Woodson of the St. James Home of Fresh Start Ministries right here in Greensboro, North Carolina. These men of God are not strangers to the Word of God, preaching and teaching the Word of God, powerful and anointed men of God. We just wanted to share some of God's gifts right here from the Triad area. Let us receive them now as we continue to hear what God is saying to us.
To our sovereign God, who's Alpha without beginning and Omega without end. To his Son, Jesus Christ, who was both man and God without contradictions. And to the Holy Spirit, who is our supreme comforter and teacher, we give honor, praise, and glory. To Bishop Pierce and all my fellow bearers of the cross, today I'm honored to participate in this wonderful experience of sharing the good news of our risen Savior on Good Friday. Good Friday is not good when we look at the way mankind treated his fellow man, but Good Friday is good because it was a precursor to the resurrection of our living Savior, Jesus the Christ. For you see, without death, there could be no resurrection of the dead. So I just want to say thank you, Jesus, to he who died but refused to stay dead. My word today is the fifth word of Jesus' last sayings, I thirst. Let us pray. Lord, help your children to hunger and thirst after righteousness with the same intensity as you hungered and thirst to fulfill every prophecy in the Old Testament and to please your heavenly Father without fail. For it's in Jesus' marvelous name we pray. John chapter 19, verse 28, the King James Version reads this: after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. I thirst is the shortest of the seven words from the cross and appears only in the Gospel of John, and the only one that refers by our Savior to his bodily suffering. Here, he's in touch with his humanity, and his humanity touches our humanity. Had Jesus not said, I thirst, we might have thought of our Lord as hardly human. But Jesus felt it all. He did not hide behind his divinity to cover his physical suffering. And he needed help from somebody to make what he wanted come to fruition. His lips were parched with fever, and the thirst of dying was upon him. And thirst, by the way, is a byproduct of utter bodily exhaustion. And Jesus is not ashamed to give a voice to those around him to ask for his help. In his journey on foot, he had felt weariness in John 4:6. In his voyage, he had been overpowered by sleep in Mark 4:38. In the desert previously, he had felt hunger in Matthew 4:2. And now in his final act on the stage of humanity, on the cross, suspended between wicked men and a righteous Father, he said, I thirst. Well, what could have caused this thirst? I find no record that he had consumed any food or any liquids since his last supper with his disciples. But can you imagine that the one the Bible calls the eternal water of life saying, I thirst? I ask the question, how is it possible? Can you picture this in your mind? After the supper, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. See Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Luke 22:44 says, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. See him now being arrested. See him being bound and carried away by the rough Roman soldiers. See him now going to Annas, then to Caiaphas for trial. See him as he faces his accusers and then is slapped and beaten. He's going back and forward between Caiaphas, Herod, Pilate, and the people, then speaking to them. See him as Pilate allows him to be scourged with 39 stripes, which brought on a great loss of blood. See him as he carries his cross to Calvary, falls beneath the weight of the cross and the heat of the day, more sweat, more exhaustion, seeing him being pushed along the road to Calvary, and then he loses more blood being nailed to the cross. See him as the blood flows from his wounds. See him as he hangs from the cross for 6 brutal hours. See him as his body is weak and drained, and yet instead of requesting anything to drink earlier, when he could have. He's instead focusing on the needs of others and the will of God. And now we hear him say, I thirst. How is it possible? How is it possible that the one in Genesis put a firmament in the midst of the waters and divided the waters from the waters? How is it that he is who is the creator of oceans, the master of the seven seas, the establishing founder of multiple lakes, and the architect and designer of rivers could ever be thirsty? John 1:3 tells us that Jesus created all things, so that obviously included water. So how is it possible that the eternal Lord of glory, the one who calmed the raging sea, the one who walked on water, the one who turned water into wine, is now asking for a drop of water? How in the world can that be? Why didn't he create a miracle for himself? Since he's the Son of God, he clearly had the power and the authority to create a miracle and provide water for himself. Maybe because it's in his DNA to resist the obvious. Earlier, he refused to turn stones into bread while he hungered in the desert. And now he refuses to create water while thirsting on the cross. He did hundreds of miracles for others. He could have easily created a miracle for himself, but he didn't. And why is that? Well, there's another side to the question. Why did Jesus wait until the last minute to say, I thirst? When he's just minutes from death, why didn't he say, I thirst at the very beginning? Why now at this moment? I believe I have the answer, and it's very important to us. His first three statements were for the benefit of others. When he said, Father, forgive them. Then he said, secondly, today to the thief, you will be with me in paradise. Then following the traditions of the older son of that time, he said, behold your mother and behold your son. Then his fourth words, which I believe are among the most haunting and awe-inspiring words ever spoken, were for all of us when he had not known sin, allowed himself to become sin so that we could have eternal life. And then I hear him say, I thirst, and again, I ask you, why now? Why not at the beginning when they first nailed him to the cross? Well, we can look at this strictly from a physical element and said, after all he had been through, his body was thirsty and he needed something to drink. However, there's more than a physical aspect of his words when he said, I thirst, because I read in Psalms 43:2 where it says, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. At first, we had no room for him at the end. And now at the last, there's no water for him to drink. But when he thirsts, they gave him vinegar. So mankind does not know how to interact with God. Could it be? Could it be that this coronavirus pandemic is all about God asking us to please him, and we are giving him something that's bitter and repulsive? He asked us for worship, and we've given him a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof. He asked for praise, and we've given him rehearsed theatrics. What he desires of us is body and soul and spirit. How often have we given him vinegar to drink? We give him our tears and then grieved him with our sins. I tell you that Jesus was thirsting for mankind. Do I have a witness? He said to his parents earlier in his life, were it not that I must be about my father's business, I have a baptism to be baptized with. He thirsts for the love of his people. He thirsts for your love. He thirsts for your peace. He thirsts for your joy. He thirsts for your happiness. He thirsts because he first loved you. I remember reading in the Word of God that there was darkness deeper than the midnight.
covered the land for 3 hours. And it was during the darkness that the sins of the whole world were poured out on Jesus, who knew no sin. But he literally became sin. And at that moment, he experienced what he'd never experienced before. Yes, at that moment, God poured out his full wrath on judgment on Jesus, and he did it just for us. You should have been suffering, but Jesus took it. You should have been getting the pain, but Jesus took it. I should have been suffering, but Jesus took it. So he came out on the other side. He paid the price for your sin and mine. That's why he cried, my God, why have thou forsaken me? I believe at that moment, Jesus suffered the worst agony that could ever be faced or endured. He experienced the agony of hell and separation from God, so I wouldn't have to. And so on that night, I came to tell you that Jesus died for you and me. He didn't ask for revenge for those who crucified him. Didn't ask for a miracle. He simply said, I thirst. Simple words. But more than that, there's nothing more that I can tell you then. In Luke 16, Jesus describes a place called hell, and he described it as a place of torment and thirst. In that parable, he described how this man in hell begged with all of his soul for someone to dip his finger in the water and cool his tongue. Well, I gotta tell you, if you wanna be with he who has living water, you gotta live, you gotta love, and you gotta serve the Lord. How it is you feel about it, but I came to tell you that Jesus said, I thirst, and he suffered. Yes, he provided a way for us to drink. He provided a way for the Lamb who sits in the middle of the throne. I heard Revelations 22:17, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come, and let him who hear say, come, let him who thirsts come, whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. If your soul thirsts during this season, come to Jesus. If you're sick, come to Jesus. If you're having problems, come to Jesus. Yes, he'll deliver you. Yes, he died for you. He had stripes that you could be made whole. I gotta close when I tell you, oh God, you're my God. Will I seek you early? My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you. In a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. Well, what I gotta tell you is, he will provide for you. He will look out for you. He'll raise you. He'll keep you. Yes, he'll sustain you. On the last day, John said, that great day of the feast, Jesus said, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living waters. I gotta close and tell you, he thirsts for you. He thirsts for righteousness. He thirsts because it was his job to die in our place. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give him praise, and he will make provisions for you. I thirst.
Beloved, we're grateful and honor and praise God this day for this privilege, this opportunity to come and to share with my colleagues as we look into the Word of God and see these last sayings of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank God for his faithfulness towards us. I have been given the opportunity to share what is the sixth word or saying of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as he died for our sins. The Word of God says in John chapter 19, verse 30, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Pray with me. God, I pray now that you will speak through this vessel of clay and convey your word in such a way that those who hear shall receive and believe. This I pray in Jesus' name. Beloved, I'm so grateful that as I read this word that I have been so privileged to share, I am grateful that Jesus, when he said, "It is finished," did not say he was finished. That gives me reason to rejoice even now. And I think that in order to fully understand what he was saying to us, when he uttered these words, he was saying that you must focus on what it actually was referring to. He said, "It is finished," not "he is finished." And in order to fully understand this, I think that we need some collaborating and corroborating scripture. For that reason, I would that you would consider what the Word of God says to us in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. This is from the contemporary English version. He says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That is, as it is said in the book of Romans, chapter 3, verse 23. Colossians makes it even clearer as it says, "There is you were dead because you were sinful and were not God's people. But God let Christ make you alive when he forgave all your sins and God wiped out the charges that were against you for disobeying the law of Moses. He took them away and nailed them to his cross." So, beloved, first of all, I want to suggest to you that when Jesus uttered the words, "It is finished," the "it" that he referred to was the sins and offenses that is spoken of here in Colossians chapter 2. And what he says, "Your sins were taken away because of Jesus's being nailed to the cross." I don't know about you, since all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, we ought to be grateful that he said, "It is finished." In other words, he was complicit in removing our sins, our offenses. Not only that, I think when we talk about it, we got to understand that there was another reason that he referenced, it is finished, and it was because of his sacrifice, his offering for our sins. He gave himself. He was a perfect sacrifice. He who knew no sin became sin for us. When he referred to it is finished, he had taken care of the sacrifice. No more sacrifice. You don't have to slay the lamb anymore. You don't have to sprinkle the blood on the door. Someone has taken the place of the lamb. He is the great I am. So when he referred to the fact it is finished, not only did he address the issue of our sins and offenses, but he also addressed the fact that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. He became the perfect sacrifice, the Paschal Lamb. But thirdly, I want to suggest that when he said it is finished, he also referred to the fact that we had a judicial obligation. In the book of Romans, chapter 7, Paul makes clear, I see a law warring in my members, bringing me into captivity. It is the law of sin and death. And beloved, you've got to know that the penalty had to be applied. And so therefore, he came not to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. And when he was nailed on the cross, he took care of our judicial obligation. So it refers to, as he speaks these six words from the cross, that he addressed our sin problem. He addressed the sacrificial offering. He also addressed the law, the statute, the ordinances. So it was said in Colossians, he took care of our sin debt. It is finished. What does it mean then? Paul recognized the need of someone who could address what we could not address, vicariously took our place. Somebody ought to get happy right now. I don't know where you are. You might be in the kitchen. You might be doing different things. But somebody ought to pause, take a selah, and think about the fact that when he said it is finished, he was talking about everything that stood between us and our reconciliation with our Creator. I'm happy today. I feel like praising God. Even now, there's so much to praise him for. It is finished. And because of that, I take delight in just referencing what Paul also said in chapter 8 as he begins. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the Spirit of life in Christ has made us free from the law of sin and death. Aren't you glad he took care of our offenses? Aren't you glad he took care of the offering? Aren't you glad he took care of the ordinance? And because he died in our place, because he substitutionarily, because he vicariously took our place on the cross, because, beloved, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's why I take delight in being a part of this time of reflection upon the sayings of Christ. Especially this do I take delight in, because so much of what I could not handle, he handled for me. I thank God that he says in chapter 8 of Romans, there's therefore no condemnation to those who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Because the law of life in Christ has made us free from the law of sin and death. And every time I think about what the Lord has done for me, my soul takes delight. I get happy. I feel like running. I feel like shouting because I can say it is finished. When he said it is finished, it gave me the opportunity to say, I am free. I don't know how you feel, but if you're free today, you ought not let any encumbrances, you ought not let any pain, you ought not let any difficulty keep you from giving God what God alone deserves. If you know that God took your place, if you know that God died for you, if you know that God gave his life that you might have a ransom to cover all of your sin, he paved. And to pave means that he covered over. And I look back over my life and see all of the offenses and see all of the wrongs that I've done. When I see that the things that I, even like Paul, tried to do but failed to do, I'm grateful that he looked beyond my fault and saw my need and said one day as he died on Calvary's cross, it is finished. And every time I think about it, it is finished. I feel like I could give God some glory and tell God, thank you. You didn't have to do it, but I'm so glad you did. I give you praise on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. But every time I think about what you did for me, Thursday, Holy Day, Friday, my Good Friday, I gotta tell you, thank you for coming into my life, giving me joy in spite of my sorrow. I can lift my hand and tell you thank you. I ask you right now to touch somebody. Let them know that you are the God of their salvation. I know that in the end, I've got a reason to just give your name glory and tell you thank you. Thank you, Lord, that what I could not do for myself, you did for me. And I am so grateful. I'm so glad that you are my Savior, Redeemer. You are my great emancipator. You are my great liberator. Every time I think about what the Lord has done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to praise you from the depths of my heart. Thank you for saying it is finished. I can say I am free. No more chains holding me. My soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. Are you free? Are you free? Ooh, 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 ooh. I'm free every day. Thank you, Jesus. I'm free. I'm free. No more chains holding me. My soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Oh, I'm free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. I pray today you are free. Because he said it is finished. You ought to be declared. I'm free. Praise the Lord. I'm shown her free. No longer bound, no, no. There's no chains holding me. My soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. Bless you.
To my distinguished pastor, Pastor Pierce, and to all of my worthy colleagues who have given to us such unique insights concerning the last sayings on the cross, it is my opportunity and my signal honor to be responsible for the last word recorded in the book of Luke as we take this moment to thank God for the privilege to proclaim the word of the Lord. Here we are now in the book of Luke, chapter number 23, verse 43, as we see our Savior on the cross. Father, we thank you and we honor you today for all of the good things you've done for us, for the blessings that you've given to us each day. We are thankful now that we come to this Good Friday, this time of blessing, this time when you came to give your life for the sins of the world. We thank you for that. We pray that as we release this word today, you will give us strength, you will give us power, you will give us joy. Right now in this time of dilemma, in this world where struggle and death has been the order of the day, we thank you that what you did gave life and it gave it more abundantly. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen. Here it is recorded in Luke chapter 23, verse number 46. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed for the last time. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he said that, he breathed for the last time. It is important as we take this few moments to set the parameters for this word. It's interesting that as we hear him on the cross, he has discussed with us several things. He's in agony. Death has come down. This is what the mission was all about. He has come to the end of his journey, to the end of his mission. He has now come to the redemptive drama that he had been called and commissioned to do. And all of the other sayings, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I thirst." As he gets down to the last two words, he begins to climactically look at, "It's almost finished. 33 years it took me to get here. 33 years it took me to stand here on this cross with these nails in my hand and my feet." And so it is important then that as we understand this proclamation and these last words, no time does he say that I'm angry. No time does he say, "Will y'all take me down?" No time does he say, "It hurts." He just now moves and takes control of the situation. And I wish I could talk about how much Jesus was in control. Everything he did, he was in control. Nothing is done haphazardly. Everything has a place. It has an order. And so it would be to our advantage to look at this particular proclamation from Calvary as he has now gone through all of the different situations, the beatings, the crucifixion, and now here he stands on the cross, about ready now, hanging on the cross, he is, and he's about to breathe his last breath. I thought it would have been a climactic moment to say, "It is finished." After all, the Apostle Paul tells us that I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. I thought that all of the stuff that he went through, "It's finished," would have been the last word, until we come to the point where we have a theological issue here, because "it's finished," the redemption, the blood has been shed. Yeah, that's finished. The work has been done. Yes, that's finished. Everything is finished. But there's one thing left. There's one thing left to do. It ain't over yet. It's not over until I say it's over. It's not over until I breathe my last breath. And so it is finished is not the last word. But here we look at Jesus. And I thought that it would be to our advantage today to examine something more readily recognizable in this particular word. And I understand that those who've articulated this word long before me were able to articulate this word from the vantage point of the hands of God. And I don't want to lose sight of that. And I hope that in this preachment, in this moment that I have with you, that I'll be able at some point to talk about his hands. But before I get there, in this age in which we're living and in this time of COVID-19, I won't talk about spirit, because spirit is important from the foundation. Everything started with the spirit. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the spirit brooded over the waters and became the divine artistry of God in reality. And so here we are when he breathes into Adam the breath of life. He became a living soul. The word in the Hebrew, the word ruach, or the breath of God, he blew into the nostrils of Adam, didn't blow into his mouth, I tell you, he blew into his nostrils so that every day when Adam got up, he could remember who made him, because he could smell the breath of God. So here we are now in this moment where ruach, where the breath of God is important. And so I wanted to talk about spirit, and I wanted to leave you. I didn't just wanted to raise just a little theological understanding, and I know that my colleagues have raised some unique moments, and I know by now you have heard a great word. You're still musing over what you've heard, but let me close and climax this session, these seven last sayings about spirit, because at the end of the day, it's about the spirit. As a matter of fact, if you go to Ezekiel chapter number 37, you'll see a moment in when Ezekiel deals with the problem of dry bones in the valley. They had lost life. They had lost spirit. They had lost ruach. And when he talks to the Lord and they began to dialogue with divinity, divinity says to him, I tell you, there is a prescription for what you see, for the problems you have. That prescription was not to go to a theologically based understanding. That was to speak to the spirit. Don't even talk to them. Tell the Holy Spirit, tell the breath of God that he needs to do in creation or in crisis what he did in creation. Let me talk about that, because I need something to happen in my crisis. In the time in which we live now, we need something to happen in the spirit. And so he says, tell you what you do, Ezekiel. You simply speak to the wind and you tell the winds to blow. And when the winds start blowing, you're going to see some activity take place and they will live again. And when the winds blew, the Bible says there was a noise and a shaking in the valley. So as a matter of fact, the Spirit of God was so powerful. And I need to jump over the Old Testament into the New Testament and see, as it relates to Jesus, when we see him in the River Jordan, the Bible is clear that he's in the River Jordan. And the Bible says that while he was in the River Jordan being baptized by John the Baptist, we saw something. We heard out of heaven the voice of God saying, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Not only did we hear that, but we saw Jesus in the beginning with the word, and the word was made flesh and we beheld his glory. It's in the water that we see him standing. We hear the voice from heaven depicting the Father. We see the Son standing in the water that depicts him in the flesh, God in the flesh. And then we see the dove that lights on his shoulder that depicts the the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's what makes that so unique. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Monotheistic. That's God in his rarest form. I don't have time to do a theological dissertation concerning this, as the implications may be more corrected by those who are much smarter than me, but this spirit thing is important. Just before he died, just before he went back, just before he told his disciples, I need you all to go to Jerusalem, and I want you to stay there until you get some spirit, until you get some power from on high. So it makes sense. It makes sense that the last word wouldn't be, it is finished, because according to scripture, the Bible said that which was born out of Mary's belly, that which was impregnated, wasn't impregnated by Joseph or any human man. This is that of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is what put into the belly of Mary the Son of the living God. I'm going to tell you how potent it was when, as a matter of fact, hallelujah, as a matter of fact, hallelujah, as a matter of fact, when Mary came to Elizabeth, I feel like hollering already, when she came to Elizabeth, the Bible said that John leaped in the belly of his mother, and she was filled with the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you, in this time where uncertainty abounds, in this time where we don't know what to do and how to do it, it's a good thing is that when we don't even know what to pray for, the Bible said the Holy Ghost will make intercessions with moanings and with groanings that cannot be uttered. So it makes sense that he starts off saying, forgive them, but he ends up taking what he was made out of and now about to commend it to his Father. The object now is that I've got to take my last breath. Now, if you look in the book of John, I'm almost through. I don't have but just a few moments. But if you look in the book of John, John will tell you, and John is not merely a snapshot of the Lord, but it's a portrait. It's not one of the synoptic gospels, but it sure gives us a clear indication of divinity in action. And all of a sudden, we hear him say in the book of John, can't nobody take my life except I lay it down. If I don't want to give it up, I don't care how much you beat me. I don't care how, you can't beat the life out of me. You can't torture the life out of me. And you sure can't crucify the life of me. I'm still in charge. No man takes my life except I lay it down. Because that is in me is of the Spirit, is of the Holy Ghost. And that's why I wanted to come by here to tell you that it ain't over till your breath that the Spirit comes. That's why I wanted to tell some of you who are grieving, some of you who are going through right now in this culture where people are dying on a daily basis, where Spirit is leaving your loved ones. I just wanted to tell you, I just wanted to give you some indication that no matter what happens, no matter how rough it gets, Spirit belongs to God. As a matter of fact, you can throw my body in the middle of the ocean, but my soul belongs to God. That's why I hope that those of you who are grieving right now can't have a massive funeral. You can't even celebrate the death of your loved ones. You're dealing with it on a daily basis. They're only letting just 10 people come into the funeral home. But I'm almost through. But I just want you to know something. I'm asking, I'm praying, and I wish I had some help. I wish you all who are looking at me right now, you may be on the internet or wherever you are right now, I just want you, if you just believe me, whatever it took God to watch his son die, I hope he gives it to you. Those of you who are mourning, those of you who are struggling, whatever it took him as a father to watch him die and as a judge to let him die, he'll give it to you. So that's why I'm closing by
telling you that's okay. He didn't give it up till he was ready to give it up. And I just wanted to tell you, if you can just hold on for just a little while longer, we'll all be able to give it up together. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not, it's in his hands now. I'm not going to commit. It's a transitive verb. It has an object on the end of it. And that's why when I give it up, I'm giving it in the hand of the Lord. And that's what I want you to do in this time of struggle. I want you to put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the waters. Tell somebody, if you'll just put it in his hands, put your life in his hands, put your struggle in his hands, he's able.
Never be defeated.
Never be defeated.
I serve a God.
Never be defeated.
Who will never be defeated.
Never be defeated.
I serve a risen King.
Never be defeated.
Who will never be defeated.
Never be defeated.
You defeated death. Yes, sir.
Never be defeated.
You defeated the grave.
Never be defeated.
And you rose to tell it.
Never be defeated.
That you'll never be defeated.
What can I say? The power of God. I know you can feel his hand moving. Here's what we want to do. Here's what we want to do after hearing the word of the Lord from all of these men and women of God that have shared. I want to offer Christ to someone that may be watching. Maybe you want to give your heart to the Lord. You want a personal relationship with the Lord. You want to put your hand in his hand. What must I do to be saved? Bible says to believe on the Lord Jesus and you shall be saved. It's just that simple. Romans 10 and 9 says that if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, that you shall be saved. Wherever you may be, we've been praying for you. We've been praying for this moment because God loves you. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, I want you to know that he loves you. If that's you, wherever you are, if you can see me, if you could hear me, and you say, I want to make that personal connection, that personal relationship is what I need. I want it. How can I give my life to the Lord? I want you to bow your head and repeat this prayer of repentance after me. Dear Lord, forgive me my sins. Come into my heart. Create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. I confess I am a sinner, but through the blood of Jesus and by the Lord's saving grace, I believe that Jesus died for my sins and he rose for my victory. And because of that, I am saved. I am saved. I am saved. And I confess Jesus as Lord of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Listen, if you repeated that prayer of repentance after me, here's what I want you to do. If you're part of our church online, it's called Reaction. I want you to start reacting there, but there is a banner at the bottom of the screen. I want you to click on there. We have trained workers that are ready to pray for you, meet you at the very point of your need. If you're part of our Facebook Live audience, and that's you, you prayed that prayer, you want to give your heart to the Lord, right in the comments section, there's a link there for how to be saved. And so I want you to click on that link, and our workers are going to be praying for you. Now, all over, everyone, let's start reacting. Lift your hands, the hands emojis, clap your hands. Let's give God praise because souls are being saved and lives are being changed. To God be the glory. Come on, give him praise. Hallelujah. For all that he's done. We put our hand in his hand. Glory to God. Listen, I am just so, so excited and so full because the presence of God has met us on this Good Friday. And there's nothing else that really need to be said. I want to thank each and every pastor, and I speak blessings over each and every church that has participated in this Seize the Moment, Seven Last Sayings of Christ. I want to pray for all of you before we leave. There's also an opportunity for you to give right now. You can give to the Lord because it is in and through your giving that we are blessed. And so we ask that you would prepare a liberal offering to give to the Lord. It's safe, it's easy, it's convenient. The link is right there. You can hit the give button. You can click on the link as we prepare to give to the Lord. I want to pray over our offering as well as dismiss us. Dear Father, we thank you now for these, your people. We thank you now for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, our hearts have yet felt. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for dying on the cross for us. We thank you for being able to seize the moment during this Good Friday day to give you thanks and to remember you and your ultimate sacrifice. Now bless those that are giving. Let no one suffer for what we're about to do, but cause us to be blessed according to your word, according to your will. We believe that it is done. Now may your grace, your peace, and the intimate friendship of your Holy Spirit continue to be with us until we see each other again. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. We love you. See you real soon.